Oh, hello there, everyone. A Merry Christmas.
It's the middle of fall.
Fuck off, Jerry. Today, we're taking a look at a classic game on a classic console. Something that I wish I grew up with. A little game called Yoshi's Island. Oops. But I got better. But yeah, Yoshi's Island is pretty good. In 1990, the Super Nintendo Entertainment System hit the world like a cultural atom bomb. And its most iconic launch title was none other than Super Mario World. Another legendary game from a legendary developer, Shigeru Miyamoto. It sold pretty well, I guess. And naturally, the developer was pressured by Nintendo to make a follow-up a few years later. After the massive success of Donkey Kong Country, the higher-ups wanted Miyamoto to utilize a more realistic art style to emulate DKC. Miyamoto took this advice, broke it over his knee, threw it in the trash, and made Yoshi's Island about a year later instead. Featuring the most cartoony art style one of his games would feature until Wind Waker came out 7 years later. Proudly displaying the creativity of its developer and refusing to ride the wave of the current trends. And I think that's ultimately what I respect about Miyamoto the most. He's not a one-trick pony and he's not a man to rest on his laurels. And if there's one game designer that could, it's him. He strives to experiment and play at the boundaries of the medium in an effort to expand those boundaries and challenge our perception of a game, how it can play, how it can control, and what audience can enjoy them. Super Mario World 2, Yoshi's Island, is perhaps his first wacky departure of sorts, a weird little experiment that openly defied the conventions of the previous game. In fact, in Japan, it was simply known as Yoshi's Island, and it wasn't really pushed as a true follow-up to Super Mario World. Yoshi's Island is its own thing. And it's a unique little adventure that's well worth trying today. The most immediately striking aspect of the game is its one-of-a-kind art direction. The Super Nintendo represents sort of a renaissance of game design, and many of its visuals still hold up well to this day. And Yoshi's Island might be the epitome of this. The bold black outlines give the graphics a timeless look that still feels crisp. Everything on screen is so well-defined, and that's to say nothing of the personality-driven character design and animation. Like, I love when Yoshi gets eaten by a frog, then gets pooped out, and he just looks at the camera like, oh god, is this what I've been doing to people all these years? You fight all kinds of creative enemies, like seed-spitting monkeys, bouncy boys, cultural insensitivity, and ghosts. The thing I admire the most about the enemy design is how varied it is. Yoshi's Island introduces the most fluidly animated Paracoopas I've ever seen in World 2, and then you barely ever see them again. That's not a complaint, it's just a testament to how much the game was committed to variety. Both in terms of presentation and gameplay, things never really get repetitive, and this contributed to an incredible sense of pacing. It's so easy to lose yourself in this game's vivid world. As I mentioned before, I did not grow up with Yoshi's Island. I beat it for the first time just recently, but the journey invoked a primal sense of curiosity and anticipation in me. It reminded me of my first journeys through the platformers I grew up with, huddled under the blanket late at night, staring at the CRT, listening to the mysterious ambience of the game's world, wondering what was around the next corner. I lost track of time with Yoshi's Island, became so engrossed in uncovering its secrets. Spelunking through underground caverns with shimmering waterfalls in the background, swimming through flooded ruins in the jungle while dodging obstacles, starting on the jungle floor and slowly climbing my way up to the canopy, hopping on precarious footholds while dodging enemies, wandering through dark corridors barely able to see what crept in the shadows, watching the mist slowly envelop the screen. Despite the fact that the game takes place entirely on a tropical island, the areas have such incredible variety and detail. Every screen feels like a new chapter in a story. So many Nintendo platformers have a knack for pulling me into a real sense of adventure with barely any words of dialogue, and Yoshi's Island might just be the pinnacle of this for me. Aside from maybe Mario Galaxy, but if you're rivaling that game, you know you're doing something right in my book. Many of the unique visuals in the game are only made possible by the special FX chip in the cartridge itself. This allowed for some crude 3D polygons and various other special effects, such as Woodstock mode. These visual flourishes are nifty. That's pretty much all I can say about them. They made the game look cooler in demos and trailers, but in the end, the bulk of the charm lies in its sprite work and the strong character designs and backdrops. In retrospect, I'm really glad that they used the polygonal stuff sparingly. This was primitive 3D technology, and it shows. It looks fine for what it is, and it's kind of impressive how well they managed to blend it together with everything else. But I'm glad the dev team decided to focus on good old-fashioned sprite work, and use the FX chip to sprinkle some visual variety on a solid aesthetic foundation. This is a team that really knew what they wanted out of the game they were making. I'm sure Miyamoto and his crew were tempted to really lean on their shiny new toys, but they showed some restraint and the end product is better for it. I can't emphasize enough how masterful the art direction is. It's a visual marvel to this day. All the environments look like they were hand-drawn and crayon by the world's most talented toddler. Everything in this game is painfully cute, and I adore some of these enemy designs. And as for the soundtrack... okay, look. I have no idea what to even say. Unless you deep dive into music theory, it's really hard to not just spew out a bunch of vague adjectives about the OST in a video game, but like... the soundtrack is insane. I can't stop humming it to myself all the time. It's burrowing into the back of my skull like an insidious parasite, and I just want my torture to end! But yeah, the music is really nice. I particularly love the build-up music for when you're approaching a boss. It gets pretty intense. Which is kind of hilarious considering how bouncy and playful the actual boss music usually is. Suffice it to say, the game pushed the Super Nintendo's sound chip to the limit. These are some of the most memorable tunes in gaming history, and it's among Koji Kondo's best works. Gameplay in Yoshi's Island is a perfectly honed machine, and due to some tight controls and excellent audio-visual design, simply running and jumping around is fun in and of itself. Yoshi inherits a lot of the fundamentals from Mario. He's able to jump on enemies to kill them, he picks up momentum the longer he runs, and he can easily change his direction while airborne. The flutter jump allows Yoshi to hover a bit in the air, allowing for great mid-air precision. The game is built around this mechanic, so trust me, the temporary hover doesn't make everything a cakewalk. You still have to carefully avoid mid-air projectiles and enemies, and make the most of your movement to get access to secrets and bonus items. Yoshi can eat most enemies and poop them out in the form of an egg. This high-speed digestive system conveys a terrifying level of body horror, and I want to stop thinking about it now. One of the most fun mechanics in the game is the egg toss, which is sort of like a little mini-game all of its own. These eggs can break through chunks of rock to drill a way forward, they can be used to ricochet off walls and bounce on water to solve puzzles and defeat enemies, you can even collect items with them. The game utilizes various little logic puzzles revolving around the egg toss, and it's a very entertaining way to interact with the world, and as far as I can tell, it was pretty unique at the time. This could have been a simple projectile attack, but they really went all out with it, I love it. I also love how creative the game gets with its set-piece moments. That chain chomp chase is something I'll certainly never forget anytime soon, as my Twitch viewers may know. Might have overreacted a little bit. The core gameplay is varied enough on its own, but it also throws some special transformations into the mix. Continuing the theme of child-friendly body horror, Yoshi can shapeshift into various sentient vehicles. Why do Yoshis have this innate ability? I don't know, but it's fun. You can turn into a fast-moving helicopter to complete high-speed time trials. You can do a bit of drilling as the mole, strategically forging your own way through rubble. You can even turn into a miniature train and drive along chalk drawings of train tracks with doodles of shy guys chasing after you. I don't know how they came up with half this stuff, but it's incredibly fun. Though I admit it's pretty hard to control the drill form. But these little segments tend to be short and sweet and never outstay their welcome. They're very minimalistic and simple, so it's good that they don't slow down the game's pacing. It's just a nice little diversion to spice things up every now and then. The same can be said for the various hidden mini-games that you can find throughout levels, or the bonus games at the end of a stage. So many of these animations just feel like the artists were flexing nuts, and I love that. It's such a creative little adventure. One of the only major faults holding the game back is the occasional cheap shot here and there. You'll get hit by something from off-screen every now and then, and certain projectiles are pretty hard to see against the background. Some of this stuff is just straight up unfair, and while it's not a constant problem, it happens enough that I think it's worth bringing up. I understand that the game is actually very forgiving about getting hit, because once you get hit, Yoshi just needs to grab Baby Mario to avoid losing a life, and to avoid hearing damage. But still, getting hit from stuff you just straight up can't see is obnoxious, and it breaks the flow of a playthrough in a big way. Again, it's not like this is a constant issue, but it's something I thought was worth mentioning. It just amounted to a mild annoyance that popped up every now and then. It's also basically my one and only complaint, so it's not exactly a deal breaker. For the most part, the game is extremely fair and introduces most of its new mechanics in a safe or easy environment before it starts throwing death gauntlets at you. And it's kind of insane just how much these obstacle courses escalate. Things get pretty hectic, but the difficulty curve is always nice and smooth. There was never a moment when I was overwhelmed by a suddenly difficult segment. There were only one or two parts that really required multiple tries for me, and I consider myself to be fairly average at platformers. At best. It's a tiny bit trickier than Super Mario World, and it certainly has a wider range of mechanics and gameplay styles to master. But it's certainly not a particularly hard game to beat. Getting 100%? Now that's another story. At the end of every level, you're graded on how many flowers and red coins you've got, as well as your star level when you hit the goal. The star level basically represents your HP, but it's kind of a weird system. It's actually sort of brilliant in a lot of ways. Whenever you get hit, your star level starts to count down, and if you can't get Baby Mario back before it hits zero, then you lose a life. But if you manage to collect a bunch of stars and not get hit too much, and hit the max of 30, then you get some bonus points at the end. This basically just amounts to bragging rights, but it's a good way for experienced players to test their skills. Red coins and flowers are simply hidden throughout the game, with red coins sometimes appearing as slightly tinted regular coins. Sometimes retrieving these items involve little puzzles or even large-scale optional sections of the level. You don't really get anything for finding all this stuff, again aside from bragging rights, but in a game as gorgeous, imaginative, and fun as Yoshi's Island, going the extra mile to explore new content is its own reward. Yoshi's Island levels feel akin to a series of miniature Metroidvania maps. Very few of the levels are straight shots, and most of them are non-linear affairs that are filled to the brim with secrets, alternative pathways, and easily missable challenges. It's very hard to find all these secrets your first time through, lending the game a nice bit of replay value. This approach is what sets the game apart from its predecessor. Alternate routes and optional rooms tend to be a bit less hidden and more obvious. It just might not be easy to complete everything on these pathways. In Super Mario World, a lot of the hidden paths tend to be fairly cryptic, but this game constantly shows the player that they have multiple directions they can explore. A huge part of this game's appeal is that never-ending sense of discovery. It's a satisfying feedback loop that blends perfectly with the beautiful art direction. You never know what may lie beyond that optional path, but it's probably gonna be pretty, and it's probably gonna be fun. Yoshi's Island is a game that's easy to beat, but if you want a bit more of a challenge, you can try to go for all the collectibles. They tend to be in hard-to-reach places and require more effort, skill, puzzle-solving, and thorough exploration to find. And the only way to ensure you have a high star level at the end of a stage is to be skilled enough to avoid getting hit by enemies as much as possible. Because of this, the game has a challenge run built into its basic mechanics, which is a novel approach to implement a sort of organic difficulty setting. Regardless of what kind of player you are, you'll find an experience you'll enjoy. Yoshi's Island is a special little gem of the 16-bit era. It has one of the most uniquely charming art styles of any Nintendo game. Its open-level design and attention to detail make it a joy to explore. To play this game is to dive into the mindset of a curious child. You can fly through the air, explore magical caves, fight giant monsters, and turn into a frickin' submarine for some reason. Few games captivate my inner child quite like Yoshi's Island.
Yeah! I'm filled with a childlike sense of wonder. I'm feeling it.
If you ever want to feel like a kid again, and get a big doofy smile on your face, play Yoshi's Island for a bit. Even 20 years after its release, it's still well worth your time. As always, thank you so much for watching. I hope you had a good time. If you enjoyed this review, might I recommend subscribing and checking out some of my other reviews in the description. I've been doing this stuff for like 7 years, believe it or not. And just remember, if you are a subscriber, you very likely missed some new vids, since YouTube is a bad website. So be sure to check out the playlist at the end screen of this video. And if you really like what I do, Patreon is the best way to support me. Even a buck or two per video really helps out. Until next time, I hope you have a wonderful day, and I hope you see a really cute dog tomorrow.